What's up, Cardboard Nation? Rob Bertrand, voice of the collector, coming at you for another episode of GoGTS Live. That crazy cat over there, you know him, you love him. Ivan Lovgren at Watch the Breaks. Hope you're all doing well, and thank you for joining us for third to the last show of the year. I can't believe another year has flown by, Ivan. What's going on?
It's winding down, Rob, and guess what? I've never been more excited to have the show because despite this being our second year winding down now, I just got access. I finally proven my worth. Check out what I can do. Oh, by the way, this is in reference to last week's conversation about how everybody peds. Look at the size of that head relative to that body. Come on now.
Oh, you're right. You're right. That's verifiable proof right there.
Verifiable proof that A, Cal Ripken is on steroids, and B, I have been given way too loose of reins. So watch out. Pay attention. Keep your eyes on the show tonight. It's going to be exciting and fun.
Well, just remember, I control the username and password for your little toy there, so those privileges can be easily revoked, mister.
I've already self-vetoed three things I was going to post, so.
Let me give you guys a rundown of what we got going on tonight. We have Mike Briele, head of production for The Bar, Pieces of the Past trading cards from Super Break. He's going to be live with us while we do a two-box break of the all-new Volume 2 from Pieces of the Past. And as always, we'll be giving the hits away. We've got a rather in-depth segment of Hobby Happenings. And then we have a second guest, the one, the only Mike Fruitman, a.k.a. The Beard, out of Mike Stadium Sportscards in Aurora, Colorado, joining us to talk about National Hobby Shop Day. And we've got there are a ton of products coming out next week, and we're going to knock them all out in a single segment. And then everybody's favorite game show segment returns tonight. We will play Trade or No Trade. And when we're ready, Ivan, I'm going to need seven contestants. So I don't know if seven. You want to, how you want to manage all that. But I'm letting you know right now that when we're ready to go, we need to have seven contestants ready to go right after Hot in the Shop.
So here I was thinking that we had a light show tonight because I saw two box breaks that are happening with a guest on. And trade or no trade. I was like, okay, so that's what, three or four? No, seven contestants to play. So make sure that you're active in chat. Make sure you're logged in. If it's live stream, if it's Facebook, if it's Twitch, if it's YouTube, if it's Periscope, wherever you may be, you got to be live in chat so that we know what's going on. And we'll do our best to spread out between those streams where you can play for. So actually, to be honest, check in with the associate producer. Do we have someone monitoring Twitch and YouTube tonight?
Yep, I'm on.
Awesome. I'm hearing the affirmative. So we're going to make sure that one of each of those spots goes to a YouTuber.
Oh, I like it. Nice.
So if you're one of the, you know, those are our more selective, not as many people are familiar with those channels, you could have a better chance to play by watching us via Twitch or YouTube. And we'll have those links flying out via the Twitter in just a moment.
Nice. Kicking things off, we want to remind everybody about the 2017 Trading Card Award Survey, which is open right now. We'll throw a link into the chat room for you guys. Chances are you voted. Our core audience, we know you guys do what we ask a lot of times. We're sure you voted. If you didn't, please do. But more importantly, we started a Gleam campaign yesterday. We know that not everyone in the hobby yet watches our show. We're working on that, and almost. We know that you can help us with that. So we thought that by incentivizing you guys to share with your Twitter and Facebook followers or whatever, by sharing the awards link, you are the specific link tied to the Gleam campaign. You will automatically be entered into a random drawing for one box of Panini Playoff Football from 2017. So we want to pick up some additional voters from your followers who may not watch the show.
Very cool. So not only can they win during that amazing show, because we'll have giveaways as usual, they can also win just by promoting the show. I like it.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
Speaking of winners, Rob, guess what? We just wrapped our November prize pack right after the show last time. But because of that, we didn't have a chance to announce the winner. So, right on top of my face, as it should be, check that out if you can read it. You probably can't, but I'm learning how to do all this. Congratulations to Brian, the Cardaholic. Brian at Cardaholic on Twitter. You should have received an email from us with details. You won our November prize pack, and as is usual, right after announcing the winner, the December prize pack will be live very soon. So make sure that you are tuned into us on social media. Twitter is the fastest spot. Facebook also has great information. Twitter.com/GoGTSLive. Keep an eye out for the December prize pack and all the ways you can enter to win. Rob, have we announced our... Well, no. I'm seeing pictures and pictures here. I think that we've got some exciting people jumping on the page. So I won't bring up a new item now, but congrats to Brian. Everyone thank him. Congratulate him on Twitter and try and work out some trades for that amazing prize pack.
We are pleased to be joined by Mike Briele, head of production for The Bar, Pieces of the Past, the trading card product from Super Break. Mike, how are you?
Doing well. How are you guys doing?
Doing very well. Thank you for taking some time out to join us. And we've got a couple boxes here to break. But before we get to that, when the first series of this came out, I was actually unaware that, you know, Scott Allen had someone in charge to do this whole thing. So let's talk mm-hmm. a little bit about how the idea for Pieces of the Past came about and your relationship with Scott and how this whole came to fruition.
Well, I think the biggest thing was obviously having sort of our first original content product. And that was a sort of a new venture. So therefore, it needed some, you know, kind of some new involvement. And so Scott and I had known each other for a very long time. And it just seemed to be in my wheelhouse. Went to college for American history, very appropriately. So I think the set is pretty much a love affair of my love for American history, collectibles, and just the production aspect of it all. So it really seemed to make sense for all of us as sort of a first, you know, entry into original content.
Very cool.
Wonderful. Now give me just a little clarity here, because this is The Bar, Pieces of the Past. Is this coming from Super Break technically, though, or where are those delineations? Because you guys have done so much. You started off just a card shop, then you got into pet products, repackaging, and now you're doing original products. Tell me a little bit of the history behind the company that's producing this.
Well, that's Scott would probably be the best to address that, but he's not here to address that. They are related, obviously, but we try to view The Bar as more original content, whereas Super Break has been, you know, really as the name has tried to imply, is something where people are allowed to open up a box and hit that, you know, incredible card that, you know, may have been from a couple years past, you know, or something else, you know, more of the repack style product. This and The Bar, that brand, which we've tried to do with some of the bigger hits that are coming out of these Super Break products, is tried to be something, you know, do something original. Where it is something that we have created at, or worked on and tried to make something truly unique out of it. And so that's really what The Bar has set out to do.
Very cool. One of the things that I've appreciated about the product is you guys have really tried to create almost a new kind of collectible to a degree with taking the documents and turning them into their own relic cards. And I'm sure you've had your share of people that go, you can't cut that up. That's an important piece of history. Just like people have said about, you know, game jerseys. Tell us a little bit about the brainstorm behind that. And I mean, you guys aren't cutting up the Declaration of Independence, for goodness sake. But what are some of the documents that people are able to get pieces of? I mean, for example, land grants are a dime a dozen, but presidents had to sign them, right?
Right. Exactly. And I think that's the thing. And we obviously, you know, as you stated, we did get some pushback. And there was actually some pushback from me internally as someone who loves history. I look at some of these documents that potentially could be cut up and think, this document shouldn't be cut up. And so we don't. There are other documents where, like you said, like land grants, where you know it did run across a president's desk and the president did sign it or whomever. In this new version, we have Benjamin Franklin, and it is a land grant. And it's a great looking document on its own, but it's something that very few individuals, much like game used jerseys, that very few individuals can actually obtain. And so for us, it seemed like a great opportunity to showcase, hey, here is a document. It was signed on an animal skin, and it passed through Benjamin Franklin's hands. Here it is for everyone to enjoy. And yes, there was pushback, but I think at the end of the day, it creates a unique collectible.
Absolutely. Has there been any internal discussion to say, you know what, why don't we, as part of the production run, save some of these documents and insert them as full-sized redemptions where you get a lucky collector gets the entire document?
That's a great idea. It's something that we haven't done yet. I think what we're trying to do is we're also trying to stay away from redemptions, even as great as these are. So I love the idea. So if we do it, I'm going to make sure we attribute it.
Okay.
But it is something. At this point, we haven't gone that route, but I do like the idea.
Okay, cool. Well, enough talking about it. Let's get at it. I've got two boxes here, and can you see this on your screen too? All right.
I can.
Awesome.
Yep.
So tell us, right off the bat, it says one pieces of the past relic card per box, 30 cards per box. Mm-hmm. Now, you guys moved away from, you changed from a pack product to all the cards in a box. What was the decision-making process from volume one to volume two with that?
Well, what we noticed and what we had been hearing was that people weren't really buying this on a pack-by-pack basis. They were buying it either by the box, and we actually had a lot of people that were opening dozens of cases of it. And so it didn't really seem to make sense to have the pack format any longer. Plus, there were some production issues with the packs. We weren't, 100% happy with how the packs turned out. And so I think for us, it just made a lot more sense to create, you know, give the consumer an individual box that is still at a very affordable price range, but without the, you know, the addition of packs, because it just wasn't serving the purpose that we initially intended.
Now, Mike, I also have a question. You know, we talked a lot about the land grants, but there's vintage stamps mm-hmm. as well that are inserted into this product.
Yeah.
Now, do you know, in general, are some of those like super, if there's any stamp collectors out there, are there like super vintage stamps, or are those just more to create a certain type of chase and collectible, rather than like there's, you know, a $2,000 or $3,000 stamp that happens to be one of the hits?
Oh, yeah, I don't, there shouldn't be any that are, you know, $2,000 to $3,000. For those, really what we wanted to do is create sort of a unique collectible and also sort of blur the line between and sort of join a couple different hobbies, from trading cards, which obviously, as we all know, is a very unique hobby in and of itself, but then also the stamp collectors. And so we found actually through some of the eBay results for some of the stamp cards from the first set have really blown us away and really made us really happy with it. And so we know that we've actually crossed over. And so we've sort of brought trading cards into stamp collectors, which is kind of which was a surprise to us. For us, we looked at it as postage stamps, and collecting postage stamps is something that is also, that is something that people across the globe, they do collect. And for us, you know, in the United States, are the postage stamps, and I imagine most countries as well, postage stamps alone tell a lot of history. And so it seemed very appropriate to bring those into an American history trading card product.
Very cool.
Very cool.
So it's just been sort of fun creation.
All right.
I definitely love that idea.
So
combining stamp collecting and card collecting. I think that's fun. Sorry, Rob, you're showing the good stuff.
So the first card we've got is a piece of the United States Constitution. And if I remember correctly, 9 of these will make a kind of puzzle, if you will, to piece the entire Constitution together. That's very cool.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah, I've got, let me pull out. So this is the thought process behind it.
Awesome. I love it.
That's great. Seriously, what collector doesn't love a product that had the idea of a 9-page, Ultra Pro or BCW sheet in mind when they built the product?
Right. It's a very common format. It's something that we can all relate to. The product itself, I think the complete set along with these, really lends itself well into the sort of a 9-page format. So that's something that we wanted to make sure that people could take advantage of should they choose to.
Does the numbering continue from volume one, or does the base set start over at one?
It actually does continue. And so the way the base set works, and there are some of the former issue in this one as well, and there was good reason behind that. But for this new volume two, it actually starts at 211 to 300. And so there are some of the former issue in it. And the reason behind that was initially we had talked about doing potentially a complete set, like a box set for the complete set. But what we decided was that we didn't want to sort of chop the legs out of the breakers and the collectors that may have acquired multiple complete sets, and maybe they wanted to sell them on eBay. And so what we, instead of creating a box set and releasing that around the same time, we decided then just to reinsert those cards into a new product, because we know we're going to tie in and bring in new collectors from this volume. So that way there's some people that are going to get these for the first time as well.
Now let's actually talk about the big hits, though. We've sort of avoided them because of the uniqueness of the relics, which come one for every box. Mm-hmm. Cut autographs of presidents, politicians, and other historic Americans inserted at random. Well, I'm sure you know the production run. Can you tell us any idea of the odds of hitting one of those and what some of the really sick autographs are that are in this product?
I think they're around 1 in 10 cases, but we've got Theodore Roosevelt, we've got Franklin Roosevelt, we've got Woodrow Wilson, we've got James Wilson, a Declaration of Independence signer, we've got Oliver Wolcott Jr., who his father actually signed the Declaration, but then Oliver Wolcott Jr. himself was, I believe he was Secretary of State, among other things. But there's some cool autographs.
Oh, we've got a relic here. We got a document. This one is a Franklin Roosevelt. Franklin Roosevelt.
Okay.
Now, can you read anything?
Yeah.
Is there anything awesomely legible on the document?
It says Box 14 Montclair. It looks like this was a
Vermont?
An envelope.
Right.
Originally handled and signed by Franklin Delano Roosevelt. Go to trading card, the bar trading card. Yes. Hello.
I'm listening. Yep. I'm listening, yep. Rob. You still got me. You still got me, Rob.
I can hear you.
Rob, what were you saying?
Are you guys still there? I can hear you.
You can hear us? Okay, yeah, we lost your video. Just make sure that you didn't accidentally click on your video camera icon on Skype there. If it has a line through it, that's no good.
Yeah. Now, Rob, you were saying, though, that you can go online and actually see the entire document. Is that what that is on the back of the card there?
There is a picture of the entire document, and it says, to view the original signed document that was used to create this relic card, along with the authentication information. That's very cool. Hold on 1 second. Mike?
That's pretty awesome.
Yes.
Check and make sure that you didn't accidentally turn off your video camera on the Skype.
I did not. It is giving me a video delay, but I am also showing that my video is not that a cutout, so I don't know if there is. Trying to take a look here.
That's all right. While you work on that, we'll keep checking this out. One of the things I noticed that as compared to the relic cards that most of us are familiar with, where the paper is kind of embedded in like a die cut window, this is just adhered to the surface of the card. Is there any concern that over time the glue used will lose its cohesiveness? Or have you guys ensured through some sort of testing that this sucker's on there and it's not going anywhere?
It should be on there for sure. One of the concerns that we do have is potentially some of the older animal skin documents, due to the release of oils, and as that document may continue to break down, that there may be potentially an issue. But from what we've tested, and we have had these sort of, you know, done the old sunlight tests and tried to make sure that they do last, everything seems to be adhering quite
okay,
fine.
Okay, cool.
So, sorry, I'm trying to resolve this video issue here.
Wow. I got another Constitution really piece. Oh, wow. We got a Dwight D. Eisenhower document relic with his writing right on that puppy. That is awesome looking.
Yeah.
And then...
So one of the things that we did this version is there are going to be more hits per box, and then there are also going to be more, you know, therefore more hits per case. And so that was something that we really wanted to make sure that we could bring back and kind of, you know, tone the percentage down of actual cases, and then really give people more for that same amount.
I like it. Who wouldn't?
I know, right?
That's very cool. Very cool. Even the base cards are extremely informative. The background or the back of the card, the copy on there is very detailed. It's one of Martin Luther King Jr., obviously an icon of the civil rights movement. You guys run the gamut. Our first base card was the Korean War. We've got Martin Luther King, James Garfield. Oh, John Brown from the Civil War. George Meade could have ended the war if he knew what he was doing with an army. Stephen Hopkins.
Well, and that was one of the things, the base cards themselves, we also wanted to make them, when you're holding them, they actually feel, you know, that sort of thick stock, that sort of velvety feel. We wanted to give it sort of that vintage historic feel. And so that's why we went with the, you know, that stock. It was more expensive to run, but it made sense. For
Chief Joseph, head of the Nez Perce tribe out of the Northwest, an amazing story. If you're not familiar with this man's legacy, you should find out.
Now, again, as somebody that enjoys history, I'm really loving this product. We had one question on the stamps that I'd like to take even further, which is you found some great historical things outside of just politicians, such as, again, Chief Joseph right there. We had a question, are any of the stamps international stamps or all they all U.S. stamps? Well, I'm actually curious, is Pieces of the Past 3 going to be more of an international product, or where's this set or series going now that this one's been out for a few days and you're seeing collector response to it?
Right. That's certainly a possibility. There are a couple things. Obviously, with American history, we can go any different direction. And there's a lot. We tried to make the cards that we released so far to really cover as diverse an aspect of American history as we possibly could, and tried to make it fairly comprehensive. Can we do more American history? Absolutely. Can we do North American history? Can we do European history? Absolutely. And so there are a lot of things that some irons in the fire, and we're just trying to figure out directions and kind of where we want to take this in the future.
I was going to lay a boom on you, Ivan, before you asked that question. We've got a one-of-one printing plate of labor leader Eugene Debs, printing plate. All right. So we are going to give away all three of these monster hits to
printing plate.
Yep, we've got two document relics from World War II era icons Franklin Delano Roosevelt, Dwight D. Eisenhower, and then a one-of-one printing plate. Booyah. Very cool.
Now, I'm curious, Mike, while we have you on, because I know that we still have another box. Or no, that was box two also, right?
Nope, so Mike, it wasn't. Where are you?
Oh, wait.
This is box two.
What's going on? There's more boxes? So we've got three hits from this box to give away. Three hits out of the 30 cards. That's pretty awesome, and actually speaks to what Mike was saying about more loaded packs now that they've gone to a single box format. Now, Mike, maybe we'll be proven wrong in this next one, but I'm looking at this. I'm seeing an FDR relic, an Eisenhower relic. Be honest, like, who are some of the lower-end relics? Because those seem like pretty good relics. Or are those the average for this product?
I would say that that break right there is a fairly average break. Now, as far as the uniqueness of the relics or the caliber of the either the president or whomever, the American historical figure of the relic, that's going to vary. But as far as the breaks themselves, the first product, some breaks were getting one or two hits. They were all getting one hit per box. Some of them were getting two. It should be every box is getting at least two hits, some getting three, like that one. And then some of the other hits are going to be one-of-one cuts. So we are trying to make it so these are fairly standard breaks.
Now also, because we all know that the people behind the scenes know exactly what's coming up, are we getting a cut auto in this next box?
it's interesting. These boxes, they were pulled out of a case, so there could be a cut, but
yeah,
going with the odds, I'm going to go with probably not. Yeah.
It's not a cut, but it is a beautifully designed stamp card.
Interesting.
Look at that, the Articles of Confederation. That's a really well designed card. I mean,
that is.
Thank you.
Yeah, I'm really impressed with the design, and even look on the back of that. You've got the element of the stamp motif for the card copy, the cancellation marks. That's just overall presentation of that is absolutely awesome.
There is sort of a historical fallacy, obviously, in that sort of that made up postage mark, because it is Washington D.C. July 4th, 1776. So it's a combination of a lot of
things,
but it creates that sort of ethos, because obviously Washington, D.C. was not the capital at the time, but nonetheless.
Well, and interesting to note,
it's a design.
I'm actually going to use my amazing, Mike, you're coming into a brand new era of GoGTS Live when I can do very cool things like this. I'm going to pulled up the stamp at Mystic Stamp Company. And
oh, cool.
Oh, it's not formatting properly in my window. Well, I'll get rid of that for everybody. But what's really cool, this stamp was issued in 1977. It was worth 13 cents then. It's actually worth 90 cents mint nowadays. So talk about inflation. 30 years, 90 cents. There was 168 million of this stamp produced. It was printed by the Bureau of Engraving and Printing. So... me with a little history.
Oh.
Kind of new and unique.
Whoops.
But, yeah.
Gerald Ford, Winfield Scott Hancock, Henry Hines. Yes. Massive industrialist.
And ketchup magnate as well as philanthropist.
Yes. Wilbur Wright. Ralph Waldo Emerson, Zebulon Pike, another piece of the Constitution, so that's three of the nine.
Rob's going to have his own
Masterson
page there.
And pieces of the past relic of Tricky Dick Nixon.
There you go. Now, you would ask before, what would be one of the lesser ones? I would say the Nixons, probably. There are a couple Gerald Fords. Those are probably, as far as presidents go, they're not as collectible, because I feel like they're all over the place. And so I think those two would probably be the...
So in the sports world, this is the equivalent of the single jersey swatch. And then the one with the writing on it would be the equivalent of, like, a patch.
Right. And, some of the pricing that we've seen actually on some of the relics with handwriting they're shockingly low because they're actually, you know, when you think about, you know, some of the documents with, you know, Abraham Lincoln's handwriting or Thomas Jefferson, it's incredibly rare to actually have any sort of piece holding their handwriting. And so some of those in sort of other realms of the collecting world, they're very expensive, like a singular piece like that. So we did try to give value, and the market hasn't adjusted as well simply because it's a trading card market and it's not as, I think, probably as aware as how rare that is.
And that's one of
it is most definitely the sort of
and that's exactly one of the reasons why I wanted to have you on, because I think there is some educational need for this product in particular, because you really are incorporating some design and relic components that are brand new to the hobby. I mean, let's face it, you know, a 2.5 by 3 piece of cardboard is hard to keep innovative over the last, you know, whatever years they've been around, and yet you guys have managed to find a way to do that, and educating collectors about that process and what's behind this, I think, is really going to help people understand just the value of some of these relic cards.
Well, and not only that, I just want to add something really fun. Greg Connolly, a viewer who teaches high school, says these would be really cool for my classroom. And I think that that's, in addition to the collector side, just the thought of being able to educate non-collectors in a new, fun, exciting way, a fun presentation of history, really deserves some props.
Right. Well, good. Well, thank you. We appreciate it. And that's something, you know, for us, we actually, that was a thought. We had kind of hoped that, you know, maybe some history teachers out there would, you know, catch wind of these and start taking a look. And we tried to focus on, you know, as I stated before, as diverse an American history set as possible. And so it really shows it's not sort of the stereotypical, you know, white guy American history. You know, it's diverse because all of us, the entire country is diverse. We've been diverse, and it really shows kind of so much of our great history, from the good and the bad.
Absolutely. I mean, we have to learn from our bad history or we're doomed to repeat it, as they say. All right, so two hits out of that box, the stamp relic and the Nixon. So we've got, from these two boxes, we got a total of 5 hits to give away.
Very cool. And awesome. I know that you're keeping those Constitution ones and building the page yourself, aren't you, Rob?
I might give it a go after that. That was cool. That was really cool.
There's a Bill of Rights one as well. So there are two 9-card puzzles. So it's a Bill of Rights and then the Constitution.
Oh, very cool.
And then the other sort of subset, I think one or two of those, maybe the Korean War, but there's an America at War 5-card subset that covers, so the Civil War, World War One, two, the Korean War, and then the Vietnam War.
Very cool. Mike, it has been an absolute pleasure. It's been a wonderful learning experience. Sorry about delivery delays last week, but certainly glad you were still available to come on this week. It's been an absolute pleasure. And listen, anytime. This is going to be a fun endeavor to watch in the future, and really excited to see what it holds.
All right. Well, thanks. We appreciate all the support. And if anyone out there is looking at ordering, definitely talk to GTS soon, because we're definitely running low on our end. So thanks.
Absolutely.
Again. And sorry about the video issues on my end. Not sure what is going on.
No worries. Hey, we made the best of it. You never know what to expect when you're live. So listen, all the best to you and your family this holiday season. Merry Christmas and happy holidays. And we'll talk to you again soon.
Thanks. Thanks, guys. Same
all
to
right.
you.
Take care. Bye-bye. Very cool.
Not to mention, Rob, I think you would agree, these cards do speak for themselves. Well, it's really fun to get the insider scoop and think about things like animal skin oil affecting cardboard over time. It's fun to get that scoop. These cards are really awesome, though. I enjoyed them the first time around when it was a pack format, and I'm enjoying them now. And it seems like they're listening to what's working and adjusting, too, which is what we always want from our manufacturers.
Absolutely. So, Ivan, tell them what they got to do.
Well, if you're new to the show, you don't know this yet, you're going to find out. If you want a chance to win, go to Twitter. You got to follow us on Twitter because, again, we have so many channels going. We can't monitor all the channels for talk and winner picking all the time. So we use Twitter as an aggregator. Go to twitter.com/GoGTSLive. Make sure you're following us. And then retweet the pinned tweet that features the winnable products. Retweet that tweet. If you want to be really fun, share the Facebook feed, share the live stream feed, tag a friend, reply to the tweet, and tag a friend that loves history. We'd appreciate all of that. Get some more viewers in here. The more viewers you get, the more likely someone like the bar Pieces of the Past is to send us 3 boxes next time, 4 boxes.
There you go.
So get some more people in here. We've got great numbers already, though. It's really fun watching the chat on both Facebook and live stream because I'm able to do 2 now, and it's fun seeing things kicking. Oh, quick question, Rob. Do you know the MSRP on a box of those?
I didn't see it
in the notes, and I forgot to ask Mike.
I can find out for you. I'd be happy to. Let me see.
Yeah, that'd be good just to let our viewers know. And I see a couple of different teachers now commenting on how much they would like them. I see one guy that hates the fact that they're cutting up anything historical. He has never thrown out anything in his life. That's okay. We still love you, William. You can still win as well, even when we disagree. We use tweet draw to pick the winners. So make sure that even if you disagree with me, you probably agree with Rob because we often disagree. And make sure that you're following us on Twitter and that you retweet the penned tweet. In fact, I'm going to go. Pardon the clickety-clack. That's just me going out to Twitter to retweet the pinned tweet on GoGTS Live's Twitter account. Oh, that stamp card is so beautiful.
It really is. It really, really is. All right, I'm looking for you. MSRP.
Also, I had one other question that I feel like that was the guy to ask, and I missed it. I missed it because I got distracted by some really fun stuff. One of my regular haters on Twitter, who I love, he's a Cardinals collector, so that's why he's a hater, J-Mac, was giving me some crap. I got distracted. I'm curious. I'd like to know if they see a performance bias in this product's sales coast to coast, because on a personal level, we see a lot more antique finds and uncovered history happens on the East Coast just because of the fact that where I live wasn't settled until 50 years ago. So I'm curious if the sales reflect that as well, or if the sales follow different demographic trends. Wouldn't that be interesting?
That would be. It looks like the current selling price of this product is between $60 and $70 a box.
Okay, yeah, so definitely something that you can make a part of your goals list or your checklist or your chump change if you're one of the few, one of the many. Which reminds me of a bone that I have to pick, Rob. Do we have time for Ivan to pick a bone?
Mm-hmm.
It's going up right now. Whoa! Look at that! Look at that! It's probably too big for the screen. Collectors making a point complaining about Star Wars Stellar Signature. No one buys a box. It's a break product. Get over it. That's my tweet of the week. That's my bone to pick of the week. That is the trivial hill I am willing to die on of the week.
All right.
How about that?
Let's switch gears here and dive into the world of this week's hobby happenings. All right. We start things off this week with some news from the world of autographs. Between the World Series, MLB postseason awards, and Black Friday holiday shopping, November is always an extremely busy time for sports memorabilia retailers. Fanatics Authentic and its partner website, sportsmemorabilia.com, have provided the top 10 best-selling athlete autographs for the crucial business month of November. Counting them down from number 10, National League Rookie of the Year, Cody Bellinger, clocks in at number 10.
And at number 9, his long-awaited Major League Baseball debut and national exposure in the World Series definitely helped. Alex Bregman slid into the top 10 for 2017.
Anthony Rizzo continues to be a hot commodity and ranked number 8.
I don't know what was so funny about that. Just got a real kick about Anthony Rizzo being a hot commodity and ranking on the top 10.
Uh-huh.
Well, Rob, it's not all baseball. Despite an injury earlier this season, Cheesehead Nation and Farmers Insurance fans everywhere continue, or is it Farmers? I don't even know. Discount double check. Continue to will Aaron Rodgers back to health through the purchase of his autographed memorabilia, helping land the Packers quarterback the number 7 spot on the list.
And gone, but certainly not forgotten, Peyton Manning's popularity remains as high as it's ever been, and I attribute it to his ad campaign for Nationwide Insurance with country music singer-songwriter Brad Paisley. But for whatever the reason, Manning clocks in at number 6.
In a departure from the last few, the following athlete is not representing any insurance companies yet. That said, he had a stellar year, and at top 5, number 5, we're going to go with none other than the reigning American League Rookie of the Year, Aaron Judge.
Due to his recent success for the Eagles, the Philly faithful have a new hero in the form of Carson Wentz, who ranked number 4th overall.
Come on. Well, as the greatest of all time, you know he had to show up on the list at some point. Coming in at number 3 is the man with 17 rings, Tom Brady.
And at number 2, the little man that could, American League MVP, Jose Altuve. Do you pronounce it Altuve?
Or is it just Altuve?
Altuve. That's what I thought.
A belief on my part.
Okay.
And finally, ranking number 1 overall in demand for autographed memorabilia, according to Fanatics Authentic, in the month of November is, Rob, a drum roll, please. Recently engaged World Series MVP, George Springer.
Interesting.
Can you believe that?
No, I really actually can't. Very interesting. In entertainment news, if you're a Star Wars fan and collector, you are in all likelihood anxiously awaiting the trilogy's conclusion when The Last Jedi debuts on December 14th.
Jedi.
AMC Theaters is giving you an added incentive to see the film at one of their locations. The cinema chain has teamed up with Topps for an exclusive opening night fan event. Attendees will receive a pack of collectible Star Wars trading cards. The set consists of 8 cards, but despite my fervent research, I could not find any information on whether or not you get the whole set or how many cards are in the pack. Anyway, still a pretty cool perk.
In auction news, it's always good when the hobby gets some mainstream publicity, and thanks to Fox Business News, the red-hot Golden Auctions Company created quite the buzz on the recent Varney & Company show when host Stuart Varney sat down with Ken Golden to discuss some of the items featured in the company's current holiday catalog. Take a look.
One of the great things about this job is you get to see, touch, and feel some of the great items of sports memorabilia and historical memorabilia. We've got a lot for you today. Things which are going to go up for auction here in New York. Ken Golden is back with us. He's with Golden Auctions. And boy, does he have some stuff for us. I'm going to start. Let's get through this fast.
Sure, absolutely.
First of all, we've got Ric Flair's Scarlet Robe. How much?
Actually weighs about 15 pounds. We expect that, to which he wore on many magazines and in the ring, to go for about $40,000 to $50,000.
$40,000 to $50,000.
Correct.
Okay. Oh, I'd pay that in a heartbeat. Okay, now here's something interesting. 1950 Ted Williams rare model bat, game, signed and everything else.
Exactly. He signed this bat, my personal favorite bat, meaning it was his personal best bat. This we also expect to go in the $40,000 to $50,000 range.
Ted Williams was something else, wasn't he?
Unbelievable hitter.
The greatest. In my opinion. Just my opinion.
Good opinion.
It's good for the price.
Yeah.
1999, Yankees World Series ring.
This is Dick Williams. He is a Hall of Famer, and he was a member of the Yankees management staff. and coaching staff, this ring we expect to go in the $30,000 to $40,000 range.
Really? Yep. $30,000 to $40,000.
Correct.
And there are dozens of them produced every year, aren't there?
Yep. They make one per player and one per coach and manager.
That's fascinating. Next one is Shaquille O'Neal's game, used, signed, and photo match. I can't read this properly. Lakers jersey from Shaq's. It was used in 1998. Where's that?
Yeah, that was an NBA championship
jersey.
Oh,
the other one.
Yep. That was NBA championship year jersey, and that we expect to go in the range of $15,000 to $20,000.
It's gigantic.
Well, he was 7'1", 305 pounds.
It still is, I believe.
Yeah, I think he's probably 355 now. I'm sorry, Shaq.
Well, next door to it, I see number 19, and that's got to be Aaron Judd's. That's got to be a home run jersey.
Exactly. That is the largest jersey ever made in baseball history. Rookie of the year jersey. He wore that when he hit a home run during his record-breaking season. We expect that to approach
$20,000. $20,000?
Correct.
He's a rookie.
Well, people say he's the next great thing for the Yankees.
And this, I believe I've got this one,
yes,
holding it in my hands here. This is the State of Nevada death certificate for the rapper, Tupac Shakur.
Exactly. This is his actual notarized original death certificate. It has, you know, cremated, has all of his information, has his social security number on there,
yes,
and says cause of death, multiple gunshot wounds.
How much?
Prop to me. You know, this could go crazy. We sold one of his prison letters for $176,000. This can go $50,000 plus.
You've got to be kidding me.
No, I'm serious. People are crazy over Tupac stuff.
A prison letter went for $170,000?
$176,000.
Okay, next case. Flabbergasted. A contract signed by Tom Cruise for the movie Top Gun. Show
yeah,
me.
This is his iconic movie. This is the movie that made him a major movie star. He only got paid $1 million for this movie. So, you know, it was early in his career. This we expect anywhere from $20,000 to $30,000.
I wouldn't. Okay, next case.
A
signed photograph from President Lincoln.
Yes.
A. Lincoln.
This is actually, and this is graded Mint 9. They grade them on a scale of 1 to 10. There are very few of these, and none of them in better condition. This we expect to approach $100,000.
Oh.
They're all available now for bidding at goldenauctions.com, and the auction concludes on Saturday, December 9th.
Goldenauctions.com.
Correct.
G-O-L-D-I-N.
G-O-L-D-I-N, auctions.com. You know I love you, Stuart. No,
thank you very much for bringing interesting items to us and our viewers. We appreciate it.
I love the appearances. Thank you so much.
Crazy. Just an insane amount of wonderful stuff. File this next story under Just for Fun. It seems no matter how long you've been involved in this hobby or how much you think you know about the hobby, one can learn something new every day, and that's what happened to me this week. Take this for example. I had no idea that 1963 Fleer baseball cards were originally meant to be packaged with cookies. It seems Fleer thought they had found a loophole in Topps Monopoly and actually started production of this packaging configuration. Somehow, Topps caught wind of this and sued. The court upheld Topps' exclusive distribution of baseball cards with food, and Fleer was forced to halt production. I wonder if any of those boxes in their entirety have survived. I've seen you eat 55-year-old gum, Ivan. Would you eat 55-year-old cookies?
You don't have to put a year on the cookies. If you put cookies in front of me, they are being eaten.
You had me at cookies.
You remember my Oreo rant from a few weeks ago. Well, we'll get back to that later. That said, if any of those boxes did survive, please tag us, GoGTS Live, in whatever reference you have. We'd love to see them. Rob, it's no secret that Babe Ruth signed a ton of autographs. In one of his more unusual autograph signing sessions, Ruth is pictured here after being honorarily enlisted in the U.S. Army in 1926. It was really just a charitable gesture on the part of the Bambino. The signed bats were to be given away as prizes to the best athlete at several dozen citizen military camps around the Midwest. As you can see, each bat carries a tag indicating the name of the camp to where it would be sent. However, that wasn't the real draw of the day. In a publicity stunt, Ruth took to the field in an attempt to catch fly balls. Not by a batter, mind you, but dropped from an airplane flying at 250 feet. Ruth was quoted as exclaiming to a group of reporters, "Gee, it's like trying to stop a bullet. What a kick that thing's got, and I can't judge it either. The wind carries it all over the place." Just one more reason why Ruth's legendary legacy is larger than life. This and over 500 other original vintage photographs, including several from the famed sports photographer Charles Conlon, are currently up for sale through RMY Auctions.
Interesting. And last but certainly not least, as we have documented on this show, 2017 has been an amazing and record-setting one for sports memorabilia and the auction business of our beloved hobby in multiple collectible categories. Well, once you know it, this week, another record fell. You might remember or have heard about this. In 1973, nearing the height of the ERA movement, tennis legend Billie Jean King defeated former men's tour star Bobby Riggs in a much-publicized tennis match that was dubbed Battle of the Sexes.
King also won in theaters near you.
With Steve Carell and, Emma Stone. King won the match in straight sets and had this to say about the $100,000 match. "I felt like the whole world was on my shoulders, and if I lose, it's going to put women back 50 years at least. Our dream was for any girl in any place in the world, if she was good enough, to have a place to compete and make a living. We knew it wasn't about our generation, but it was about the future generation." Well, recently, this very racket, the one used during the match, was sold at auction by Bonhams in New York. The gavel dropped yesterday afternoon, as a matter of fact, with a final bid price of $125,000. It is believed to be the highest price ever paid for a single piece of women's sports memorabilia. King had originally donated the racket for a charity auction to benefit her own foundation, Women's Sports Foundation, in 1982. And that's a wrap for this week's Hobby Happenings.
Lots of fun, exciting stuff going on there this week. How about that Ric Flair sequined robe? Let's talk about that for just a second, Rob.
Right?
I mean, come on. Who doesn't want that? I wouldn't be surprised. That's the type of item that may go for higher than you could argue it may be worth, just because of the work he has done in the athletics community, going around and being a motivational speaker for different athletes. I could easily see a football star putting down like multiple six figures for that. What do you think?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. I think if there's one wrestler whose ring attire would garner that kind of money, I certainly think Flair would be the guy. First off, because it's so extravagant, elaborate, colorful, and full garment.
Oh, come on.
You know,
you didn't
a
have
lot
more
of times
than that.
Well, a lot of your, times, you
your
know,
wrestler speak is it's letting me down a little bit. Come on, exuberant, elaborate.
Well, I'm saying, I mean, what can you say about guys' ring attire? Usually, it's what do they call that? A singlet or shorts and a t-shirt or trunks or something. I mean, yeah,
maybe in the modern WWE that you're watching. I remember the Macho Man. He would have like a crop top jacket that was sequined with a singlet, with another Speedo underneath. That's what we need more of in WWE. I will come back and start watching it if you bring me more of that.
All right.
But
so
yes, I agree with you.
So you think, I think six figures is probably a little high. I think it's actually a lot high. I would put the over under on at about 40 grand on that.
I don't know. I think that one of these like defensive guys for the Raiders or something is going to drop down 250 on it.
Just huge, sick coin.
Yeah. Yep. So, I don't know. And then wear it. Wouldn't that be awesome to wear out of the tunnel if you were a football player or a basketball player? Couldn't you just see Blake Griffin?
It would be beyond cool. Yeah. It would be beyond cool.
So, live vicariously through me. I'm guessing that Emma Stone bought that racket, and I really want Khalil Mack to buy that.
Did you happen to see that movie?
No, I didn't. 10-month-old kids. I'm looking at this month's movie schedule.
And oh, yeah, you haven't seen any movies.
Opens up here in a couple days here in tomorrow, The Shape of Water, which actually a good friend of mine is the star of that movie. Looks so freaking amazing, the new Guillermo del Toro movie. Then we got The Last Jedi. Guess what, Rob? I had to turn down, humble brag, I turned down a ticket to the Bright premiere next week. Have you seen the trailers for that with Will Smith? It's Max Landis's big budget movie, Will Smith and Joel Kinnaman or Edgerton?
No. Yeah, I haven't heard about it at all.
Looks amazing. It's about a world where like the fantasy world and the modern world are the same. So it's a cop buddy movie between Will Smith and an orc cop played by Joel Edgerton. And it's written by Max Landis, who's John Landis's son, and has written like 17 screenplays that have sold in the last 5 years. He's just now getting out there. He's one of these super hip, smart millennials that does all of this stuff, like him or hate him. He does a lot of this stuff. So you got to see that. There's just so much coming out. I mean, I'm not going to get to see The Last Jedi until it comes to Netflix or something. And it won't even come to Netflix because by that point, Disney's going to have their own streaming service and they're going to own Fox and all the movies are going to come out on Disney's streaming service and Netflix is going to crash. We're all going to burn. That's how I feel about movies right now.
Wow.
Don't at me, bro. Don't at me.
I don't even know what to say about that. I don't even know what to say. That's absolutely crazy. You're nuts.
It's movie season. What can I say? And I got all these friends that are in SAG that are watching all the screeners and they're reviewing them and they're saying all these things. And I'm like, no, you're spoiling it. You know, The Post. The only reason I want to see The Post, no offense, Tom and Meryl and Steven, is Bob Odenkirk. Who doesn't love Bob Odenkirk? Knowing that Bob Odenkirk is in a Spielberg movie, I got to see it. Not going to have a chance until probably next week or next year at this time.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I have more time than you do, but I'm still pretty stingy as far as like what I'll budget my time on. Mm-hmm. And indie films are out. Anything that might win an Academy Award for Best Picture is usually out just because they're so boring. And like I said, we've had this conversation.
I love that. The Winston Churchill movie with Gary Oldman.
Now that one definitely looks good. That one definitely looks good and potential Academy Award winner. Now, let me, I only say that
the lose.
I only say that because listen, we've had this conversation before. I know what a good film is and it doesn't always mean I'm entertained by it. There is a distinct difference. And when something can be not only a good film and be entertaining, you've really struck some genius there. I mean, looking back at some of the last Best Picture nominees, I've just been like, really? Really? I mean, granted, I haven't seen La La Land yet, but I have absolutely no interest in seeing La La Land.
Yeah, nobody has any interest. Only musical theater kids have interest in seeing.
Yeah, exactly.
As a former musical theater kid, come on.
Exactly.
Nobody likes La La Land. Here's another one, though. Guess what else? Two movies next week. Downsizing, the new Alexander Payne movie featuring Matt Damon and Kristen Wiig, which is a remarkable concept. Have you seen this trailer, Rob? I should pull it up and we should just broadcast that now.
Why do you have all this time to see these trailers is what I want to know.
Well, it's only, I take a lot of poops.
All right. Let's shift gears.
We'll talk about downsizing after this. But Rob, I understand that National Hobby Shop Day is coming up. And so we have a special guest to talk a little bit about that and a little bit about the side of the hobby that collectors love.
Damn, who is that?
I think it may be the man, the beard himself, Mike.
Well, wait a minute. I'm totally thrown off. Yeah, it's Mike Fruitman from Mike Stadium Sports Cards in Aurora, Colorado. Fairly clean shaven.
Oh, you are
wearing what? Contacts and a haircut? What's going on?
I had a buddy who passed away, and he was known for having a crazy beard. So I went a whole year to kind of honor him. And plus, it allowed me more time to get to the shop and, you know, other things. I didn't have to waste my time in the morning.
Well, that makes sense. That makes sense. Well, listen, welcome back to the program, Mike. Excited to have you. It's been a very few busy weeks for me as the senior marketing manager for the sports and entertainment division of GTS Distribution, and I have you to blame for that. And I say that in the best possible way, because National Hobby Shop Day was an idea that you had and passed along, and I clicked on it right away, and I got it, and I ran with it the best that I could. And it culminates this weekend, Saturday, December 9th, with 41 stores participating across the country in its inaugural year for an amazing in-store event, which is going to include memorabilia giveaways, pizza party or other beverages and snacks, free supplies, packs, all sorts of fun stuff. Tell us what Fruitman has planned at Mike Stadium Sports Cards on National Hobby Shop Day.
We're just going to go low key. I mean, we've got a card show at the card shop. We're going to have 10 or 12 tables. We've got guys who are going to be set up outside the store. It's going to be 63 degrees. It's very comfortable for Colorado. So we've got that going on from 10 to 5. We're actually very lucky. We're going to have Jerry from Upper Deck. She's my rep. And Chris Carlin wasn't available. And we're glad to have Jerry coming by. So we're going to have all sorts of awesome Upper Deck prizes. We're going to be doing a trade night. What else? We're going to be doing it. Well, of course, Upper Deck's going to be here. We're going to be doing a black diamond case break that evening. And then we're going to be giving away more prizes than I've ever been able to give away before. I think I spent more on this promotion than I did my car. I've got a 2016 or whatever cross tour. But I think I spent more on this promotion. We've got, here you go. Here we go. I brought cookies for Ivan. So we got a little prop right there. There you go. And what else? Yeah. So we've got, here, is it going to fit in the whole thing?
Nice. I see
that,
it.
Mike, can I say something else that I found from your Facebook, actually, because I stalk you there. You're also, because Upper Deck is there, you can bring your expired, unscratched Upper Deck Sports redemptions to your shop, buy an Upper Deck box, and you can win one of many prizes that they're giving away so that the expired redemptions don't have to go to waste. I think that's pretty awesome of you to coordinate that with them.
You know, that's just Upper Deck stepping up and assisting hobby shops. You know, they send a bunch of stuff out here and they're like, use it wherever you want. And I always see that promotion. We do it at the industry summit sometimes. Now we'll do it at the Upper Deck event in Orlando, I'm sure. And then we also see it done at the national. And I'm like, okay, if that could get done there, it can obviously be done at the shop level. So we've got some great prizes. We've got some single cards. We've got an autographed helmet from the fourth overall pick. Unfortunately for the Avs, he went back to college, but he's still the fourth pick. And actually, the cool thing is he doesn't have a lot of autographs. He doesn't have, well, I haven't seen any autographed cards of him. So there's a chance for collectors to get that, some cards. My coolest thing, I know you guys are going to laugh, but we are actually going to have some of the Upper Deck calendars. And I like fight and claw. And like I go to these events like Orlando. You're going to have to watch me because I'm going to try to steal as many calendars as I can because Upper Deck makes the coolest calendars there. So those are going to be prizes. And so here's something at the shop level for collectors to bring it in starting at 10 a.m. in the morning at the card show at the card shop. You can bring in your expired redemptions. You don't have to be here that night. We'll take care of you. Pick up any box of Upper Deck. Obviously, you know, new box of Upper Deck 1 or Black Diamond would be nice. And then, we're going to go ahead and have as many prizes as we have. We'll take that many cards in. And you know what? If we get so many people who want to drop off more, I'll probably just scrounge to the back and find some more Upper Deck cards just so we can take care of as many people as possible.
That's awesome. Absolutely awesome. Yeah. Something that popped in the industry news today, I'd like to get your feedback on. In your most politically correct spiel as possible. It came down the pike from Topps that they're going to do their own industry conference following the suit of Upper Deck. What is your reaction to that, and what do you think it says about the future of the industry summit?
Well, first off, I'm probably at the card shop level the biggest flag carrier for the industry summit. I love catching abuse and catching flack on DealerNet and other places where it's talked about. And I don't know if my shop would still be open if it wasn't for the ideas and communication that I've enjoyed at the industry summit. And, you know, Upper Deck wanted to go a different direction. They wanted to control their own thing last year, and they did a tremendous job. They literally last year, it reminded me of how over the top it was back in Hawaii. I went to two of those events, and the opening greeting, the opening night, they have a crazy party with Mike Madonna there. The next night we go to this bar, and it's a boxing themed bar, and Mike Tyson rolls in. But I mean, that part was obviously great. But the communication that was done there at the upper deck level was incredible. And it's something that I would love to see every year. At the industry summit, they brought in outside guest speakers who were able to inform me about ideas that really I should be implementing in my store. To see Tops do it, God, you know, hopefully I do it so well this weekend that I can afford to go to all three trips. You know, it's three plane tickets, it's three hotel stays, plus I got to cover the shop. And, you know, it's very difficult to do all three of those things. So you've got a January event in Orlando, which I'm already booked to go. And now, literally in two straight weeks, you're going to have the industry summit and the Tops event. So, I mean, I haven't made any plans yet. I don't know what I'm going to do. Let's just break it down. So it's going to be Dallas in February. Yay. We're going to go see a basketball game, which I know for a lot of people is awesome, but that's literally what I do 41 nights a year. I work at Pepsi Center, so I get paid to see Nugget games. So that I guess, would be fun. But, you know, looking at the Tops event, and before we get down to the programming, it's February in Arizona. And I'm looking forward to that. Plus, they're doing it at Talking Stick Casino. I don't know if they've announced that yet, but they're going to be hosting the event at Talking Stick, which is actually where the Rockies stay. So I've never gone to spring training first games are actually on the 23rd. Done a little bit of looking at this morning. So it starts on what? I think the 18th, 19th, and 20th. So you've got a casino, Arizona, February. That sounds kind of good to me.
Well, Mike, shifting gears a little bit, I just want to give collectors a little glimpse of you and the kind of shop owner you are. I hope you don't mind. I went on your Facebook as well, and I pulled this screenshot. You shared a little text message conversation, keeping it confidential still, but you actually had some collectors come in, because we always wonder about this. Okay, if something happens to me and my kids take my collection or my wife takes my collection, are they going to get hosed? Are they, you know, what is it? And this couple came into you, and it sounds like you weren't pushy at all. You said, look, here's what it is. You know, that's my piece. And then they came back to you with these wonderful words. So I just wanted to share that for collectors everywhere. You know, they did shop around and they found you quoted them something completely fair. And they came back and they said that, you know, you were the guy. So in this age of transparency and fear, it's really nice to see that, especially from a hobby shop owner. So just a little vouching for you there.
Like, you know, it's kind of like, I think the face of the industry is a guy from Arnold's Dungeon from The Simpsons, and the guy who was in the movie with Brendan Fraser, Back to the Future, Blast from the Past. And you know, as card shop owners, I mean, we don't have the greatest reputation. I think we're kind of seen as shysters. I think we might be one or two levels above lawyer, perhaps. But I mean, I'm looking at my front window now. I've got six giant panes of glass. That I've replaced them once. We had a fight outside. It's another story. So I've replaced them once. That's about a $2,000 bill. And so I've got $12,000 worth of glass right there. And I have no desire to tick anybody off and lose any glass. So I got to sleep at night. I've got to know that I'm paying people the fair prices. And, you know, these days, you can lose your reputation literally overnight. Al Franken, politician, sorry. You know, you can literally lose your reputation overnight. So it's just not worth hosing somebody, giving somebody a bad deal. And did I make less on it because I paid more? Sure, but I got the collection, took care of a lot of collectors. I had some there you go, perfect. I had some Braves Johnston's cookies that I've never owned from 54 and 55, and those things didn't last at all. We're just going full circle with the cookie thing tonight.
Yeah, the whole show tonight is all about cookies.
That's awesome, whether you realize it or not. In the segment we did just before you came on, we were talking about no matter how long you've been in the hobby, it seems like you can learn something new every day. And this week I learned that originally 1963 Fleer Baseball was designed to be packed out with cookies, but Top sued under the exclusive food distribution and was able to halt production. And yet an image of a box surfaced on one of my Twitter feeds and was like, wow, I had no idea. So this whole concept of cookies, it's been the theme of tonight's show, and you didn't even realize it.
Well, you know, if it wasn't for the 63 Fleer set, we wouldn't have the Joe Adcock short print. I mean, how could we live without the Joe Adcock short
there
print?
There you go.
Wait, am I allowed to say that?
Okay. Absolutely, absolutely. Listen, I wanted to thank you personally for putting your money where your mouth was with regards to this promotion. I think we built something good that is going to be even better next year. I wish you the best of luck at your event Saturday, December 9th for National Hobby Shop Day. We appreciate your support and partnership as always, and I look forward to seeing you at various events coming up in the various near future, my friend.
Yeah, I might see you at three of them, and you know, I'm looking forward to Saturday. It's an incredible chance to for hobby shops, and I know it's too late for anybody else to get involved, but it's an incredible opportunity for us to give back. I mean, everything I got from this promotion, and packs arrived today. You guys sent out like a crazy amount of bonus packs. It's on my Facebook page and Twitter. Every single thing you guys give us will be given away. And you know what? There's nothing cooler than seeing people walk out of here with something that, you know, is going to go on their wall, and that I get to, you know, in one sense, we're just a hobby shop, but we're really not. And it's a fun place to hang out. And this weekend, we're going to prove that. So thanks to everybody who, all the shops who participated, who stepped up, who got involved. I know it's a first year deal and ordering a lot of stuff during the holidays. With all, I mean, I saw what's happened in the shop. I mean, I know what's on the on deck circle for this week and what we got in and all the things that are coming out next week. But for that many shops to step up in its first year is kind of impressive. And I'm looking forward to seeing what we can do next year. And Rob, I owe you some drinks, man. I got you covered when I see you either in Orlando or Dallas or Arizona. I got you covered.
I'll take you up on it. Take some good pictures of your event this weekend so we can use them for PR purposes next year. Mike, all the best. Great having you, and Merry Christmas, Happy Holidays, Happy Hanukkah.
Thank you so much. Hey, Ivan, stay safe out there. Hope everything's good.
Thanks for mentioning that. Well away from the fires on our end, but hoping and praying for everybody that is close to them. So thanks, Mike.
Take care, buddy. Mike Fruitman, Stadium Sports Cards. Be sure to check out his Facebook page for an idea of just what National Hobby Shop Day is going to be all about.
Well, and that's pretty impressive. I had no idea. I know that Mike's always been great with feedback, great with innovation. I thought it, when I saw him on the list tonight, I was like, well, of course we have Mike on. He's a great guest. It's a little unfair sometimes, though, to, you know, always have him. Well, who knew that he came up with the idea of National Hobby Shop Day? That's absolutely awesome and well-deserved. And I cannot believe 41 shops reached out to GoGTS Live for money for a pizza party, special prize boxes, special autographed memorabilia prizes. So that's really awesome. That's almost every state having a National Hobby Shop Day shop celebrating.
I mean, the idea was born out of the fact that, you know, he came to us, and I mean, one of our themes is partners in success here at GTS Distribution, and Mike has always been a good partner, and he came to us and said, you know, the couple weeks before Christmas, right after Black Friday, are some of my slowest of the year. People are spending their money elsewhere. Yes, they're doing some Christmas shopping the week before Christmas in the shop, but he's like, this time can be really slow. It'd be really great to have some sort of promotional event. And so he and I spoke, and we put this together, and I ran with it, and thus National Hobby Shop Day was born with the full support of GTS Distribution. So that's where we're at, and hopefully we get more stores participating next year so you, the collector, can take advantage of it. To see a complete list of the participating stores taking part in National Hobby Shop Day this Saturday, be sure to visit GoGTS.net or the Facebook page National Hobby Shop Day.
Or I just put the link in both Facebook and live stream chat. So the link is right there. If you just want to open that in a separate window and browse through it at your convenience once the show is done. Also incredibly interesting, though. This is why I love, you mentioned you learned something new in the hobby today with a very obscure thing from 1963, cookies, wax packs, all of that. And go to my own Twitter, watch the breaks, and retweet my tweet asking Topps to produce cookies since they stole them from us 50 years ago. After you do that, though, I just learned there are so many releases in December, Rob, that it's stunning to me to hear a hobby shop owner say, Black Friday good, week before Christmas good, the rest of the time is really slow. We've got like 12 items on hot in the shop this week, and that seems to always be the case this week and next week in December. So really interesting to have a hobby shop owner on and be able to get the actual reality versus sometimes, you know, we love the manufacturers, we love the hobby shop owners, they're not always on the same page versus the wants and the needs. And so that, it seems like the timing couldn't be better on this.
Absolutely. So let's, speaking of hot in the shop, let's take a look at next week's new releases. Kicking things off, we have 2017 Leaf Buyback Wrestling Cards. 2017 Leaf Buyback Wrestling Cards delivers, wow, is this right? 11 autograph cards signed on card in every box. Look for some of the greatest names in professional wrestling history from cards produced from multiple manufacturers over the last 40 years. As you would imagine, this is a very limited production run. Just how limited? 99 total cases. There have been a lot of companies that have produced wrestling cards since the WWF and ECW's inception, and you will find several of those included as buybacks in your 11. I mean, we're talking licensed manufacturer buybacks for manufacturers like Classic, Tops, Fleer, and more. Look for some of the greatest names in professional wrestling history like Hulk Hogan, Bret Hart, Jesse Ventura, Shawn Michaels, Bobby Heenan, and many, many, many more. An amazing value, ideal for group case breakers or the casual and diehard wrestling fan alike. 2017 Leaf Buyback Wrestling hits hobby store shelves next week on, of all things, a Tuesday. So being the first hot product in the shop next week will be Leaf Buyback Wrestling.
Well, Rob, it's not the only product hitting hobby shelves on Tuesday of next week. On Tuesday of next week, Tuesday the 12th of December, 2017, we actually get a 2018 baseball item. Yes, that's correct. 2018 Onyx Icons Collection Hall of Fame signed baseball edition. That said, no offense to Onyx, the year doesn't matter because this is a packed product with Hall of Fame signed baseballs, as well as a vintage graded card in every case. So it's not just 2018, it's actually timeless. And there's a limited production run of only 25 total cases. So a well-curated product here. 12 boxes per case for those of you that are into breaks on products like this. Each box, again, will include one autographed baseball as well as one graded vintage card per master case and four per three-count mini case. Some of the highlights from this is that each ball comes in a custom-made, security-sealed keepsake box. And the signers include, remember, 25 cases, 12 boxes per case. So you do the math. Everyone has a calculator. Hank Aaron, Willie Mays, Stan Musial, not a sticker auto, Ted Williams, Nolan Ryan, Reggie Jackson, Mickey Mantle, and many, many more. In fact, you can see the complete checklist for all details. And then again, one vintage graded card in every case. Those cards include a 1967 Steve Carlton rookie, various Mickey Mantle cards. Every vintage card will be of a Hall of Fame player from the 1960s or earlier. And guess what? One 1968 Nolan Ryan rookie. So if you have ever wanted to chase a Nolan Ryan rookie, as well as get a great autographed baseball for your collection, check out breaks of this, check out boxes of this, check out cases of this. 2018 Onyx Icons Collection Hall of Fame signed baseball edition.
Closing out the Bowman calendar for the season, 2017 Bowman Chrome Baseball Card Minis Complete Sets drop next week and commemorates the unforgettable 2017 baseball card class. Each mini size set will include players featured in 2017 Bowman and 2017 Bowman Chrome. The complete set will include the heralded rookie cards of players like Aaron Judge, Cody Bellinger, along with first Bowman cards of Ronald Acuna and many more. In addition, each complete set comes with three bonus packs of 10 exclusive refractor parallels. The regular refractors are limited. Blue Shimmer and Green are still will be numbered, but in a to be determined quantity. The Bowman 70th logo will be numbered to 70, gold numbered to 50, orange to 25, red to 10, and of course super refractors and printing plates as well, just in time for the holidays for an easy gift for the collector on your list. Bowman Chrome mini sets.
Rob, let's switch gears now to the hardwood 2017-18 Panini
Hoops, totally, baby! Hoops!
Totally certified NBA Hoops. No, not Hoops, the brand. Hoops, the game. Basketball cards featuring none other than the Lonzo Ball on the box. Hits shelves at your hobby shop. Each box is going to deliver one autographed card and one memorabilia card, including stunning on-card autographs from the best and the brightest stars of the 2017 NBA draft class. And I have a question after this. We'll get into that, though. Each pack, each box is going to include eight packs, five cards, configured as a 2x8 count inner case, inside of a case. The autograph card in every box could come from rookie roll call single.
Did you say 2x?
I said 2x. You got it. Yes, I did. Double X like the average hobby shop hobby shirt. That's what I said. On-card autographs with multiple parallels of the rookie roll call single and duels. There's also multi-signed rookie autographs numbered to 25 featuring star-studded combinations like Markel Fultz and Lonzo Ball. Well, is that star-studded? I'm not quite sure. Only time will tell. That said, there's also veteran and legend autographs, including choice signatures, signed, sealed, and delivered. And the memorabilia card could include fabrics of the game, iconic memorabilia cards of the NBA's top rookies and veterans, including multiple levels of prime patch parallels. There's a new 2017 insert emblazoned with an eye-catching spray paint design and featuring only the best 2017-18 rookies. Performance be damned. The 2017-18 Totally Certified Base Set also has stunning base and base rookies parallels numbered as low as 1 of 1 for the set collector. Check out GoGTS.net for the entire checklist in downloadable PDF and Excel format for you to build your set of 2017-18 Panini Totally Certified NBA Basketball Cards.
Leave that slide up there for a second, Joe.
I'll cut you.
Two times 8-count inner. What that means is, yes, there's 16 total boxes in a case, but that case is divided into two cases, two inner cases, each containing 8 boxes.
Yeah, that wasn't clear.
I just wanted to clarify in case it wasn't.
Totally clear.
All right.
Clearer than an acetate cookie.
All right. Next up, I can't believe it's here already. Transcendent Collection. We talked about it when we first heard about it. Watch this video. I'll give you some more details. The brand that's really come to define the pinnacle of super fragilistic XBLadocious premium MLB collectibles returns. And this year's VIP experience features the one and only Hank Aaron, the real home run king. 2017 Transcendent Collection baseball cards debuts next week. Severely allocated at only 87 total boxes produced. Why 87? Because Topps' love affair with 1987 baseball continues. You will find in every box an Aaron Judge, 1 of 1, Topps history autograph card. One of one, cut signature or MVP autograph or dual autograph, a 1 of 1 transcendence moment sketch card, or brand new MLB baseball sketches, meaning the ball itself has been artistically decorated with the likeness of a player. An oversized 1 of 1 cut signature card. 50 transcendent collection autograph cards numbered to 25 or less. One complete 50-card Transcendent Collection base set featuring, you guessed it, the 1987 design with chrome technology, a die-cut wooden border, and a silver frame, every card being numbered to 87. One complete set of Transcendent MLB Moments sketch card reproductions, and, of course, the aforementioned Hank Aaron VIP Experience Invitation. A product not for everybody, but as I like to point out, thanks to Ivan's research, when you break this product down in terms of return on value at a box break level, it's something that you can afford because it's going to cost as a slot in this is going to cost you as much as a higher end box with the chance to walk away with some pretty amazing collectibles. Transcendent Collection, we know, isn't for everyone, and it'll be interesting to see how long it lasts, but obviously it did well enough to bring it back for another year. It comes out next week.
Yes, I do feel, in all fairness, we should say past performance is no indication of
future performance.
Those good, fair enough. Last year's numbers.
Fair enough. We'll see. Okay.
And I say that as the biggest advocate for this product, and you saw my trivial collecting hill I'm willing to die on this week was that collectors need to get over complaining about not being able to afford a box of Transcendent or Stellar Signatures. They're not designed to be a box. They're designed for a different type of collector that likes to break. They're designed for break spots. That's what it's designed for. So none of this $27,000 box. Transcendent Collection is awesome. And if you are into that sort of thing, if you are happy paying $200 for a baseball with Noah Syndergaard's face on it, then you will like this product. If you're not, there's plenty of other products for you. Plenty of stuff that's hot in the shop this year, this month, this week. Go to your hobby shop for National Hobby Shop Day, whether they're celebrating or not, and ask for 2017 TriStar Signature Series. If you're looking for something a little bit more hot in your mind, each box of this product, actually, sorry, each envelope of the year-end edition of TriStar Signature Series is going to deliver an autographed memorabilia item with hot hits with an average secondary market value estimated over $450. So if you want a higher promise for your high-end dollar, you can find items signed by more than 275 subjects, including, I'm sure you're all looking at it, I sure am. Look at that beautiful list. Pop open the window. Dive in deep. Look closely, or just go to GoGTS.net where you can pull up that image and make it full screen. Some exciting memorabilia signed by athletes, entertainers, and politicians like Barry Sanders, Ted Williams, the aforementioned Will Smith, who has a great-looking film premiering in a few weeks, Mike Tyson, Mark Wahlberg, Kobe Bryant, Chevy Chase, Jose Altuve, whose autographs right now are number 2 on the Fanatics Authentic sales list for November, Matt Damon, star of Downsizing from Alexander Payne, which is another movie I had to turn down a preview ticket to this week, Ric Flair, who we know is hot, Hulk Hogan, who's always hot, oh, and just some classics like Sandy Koufax, Gordie Howe, Ted Williams, Mickey Mantle, Angelina Jolie, Brad Pitt, Pele, Eddie Murphy, Austin Matthews, Richard Petty, Jerry Rice, Dan Marino, Nolan Ryan, Oprah Winfrey, and many, many more. Essentially, as Oprah says, you get an autograph, you get an autograph, you get an autograph. TriStar just became Oprah and put her into their product with 2017 TriStar Signature Series year-end edition. So keep an eye out for that. If you are an autograph and memorabilia collector, it is going to be hot in the shop this week.
Interestingly enough, next week closes out the 2016-17 Upper Deck Hockey calendar. Yes, the cup has already been released. Yes, the cup is usually the last product of the year. This year, the last product of last season is black. 2016-17 Upper Deck Black NHL Hockey Cards delivers 5 premium cards, including 4 autographed material or booklet cards, with no less than 2 on-card autographs guaranteed, plus 1 premium base or parallel card in every box. Black features a new configuration and a lower box price. Hand golf claps all around on that. All autographs are signed on card. Sweet. Sweet. Lustrous rookie signature cards featuring 35 top NHL rookie stars from the 2016-17 season, printed on gleaming acetate surface with rare black and blue parallels numbered to 5. new color-coded autographs and jersey cards featuring some of the most stunning autograph cards of the year. New black hole relics and premium relic cards, including autograph parallels of the NHL's top rookies, stars and legends, pro penmanship with single, combo, and trio on-card autographs, more gleaming acetate surfaces, and one premium base or parallel card in every box. A real challenge with the 40-card base set number to 299, parallels number to 25, and one of one. Put a cap on the 2016-17 NHL hockey card collecting season with Upper Deck Black in stores next Wednesday.
Well, Rob, as we mentioned in our December movie preview, this month we are getting Star Wars: The Last Jedi. And along with The Last Jedi comes 2017's Topps Star Wars high-tech trading cards. Popular set returns with the Star Wars brand on Topps' well-known dynamic patterned and paralleled acetate set high-tech. This year's fan favorite also returns with new autograph signers, including one autographed or dual autograph card in every box. There are over 40 autograph signers from across the Star Wars saga, which means there's actually more signers in this than there are in top stellar signatures. Think about that for a minute, including first-time signers from the latest film, Rogue One. There's tons of parallels in this. Title number
75. I think it's Rouge. I think it's Rouge one.
Yeah, sorry. Yeah. Moulin Rouge 1. Gold Rainbow Foil, number to 50. Orange Magma, number to 25. Green Cube, number to 10. Red Orbit, number to 5. And Black Galactic, numbered 1 of 1. See how they added all those cool spacey words to the otherwise general refractors and defractors and profractors and unfractors and infractors and z-fractors. Well, that's not all, Rob. There's also four insert sets with a total of 56 cards. So if you're building a master set with all the insert sets, you're going to have to collect heroes and villains of Star Wars: The Force Awakens. Troopers, showcasing the different types of troopers from across the saga, which we know from our pop culture studies are vastly, vastly popular. I'm amazed at the following that stormtroopers have. Well, now they get their own insert set. There are also Rogue One vehicles with a look at the special vehicles from Rogue One, a Star Wars saga, as well as a more elegant weapon featuring the character who wielded the most iconic lightsabers from across the saga. That said, if you want to see the signers list, you see the full checklist, including, it looks like, Grand Admiral Thrawn is in this product. Bachoom! Go to GoGTS.net and search for 2017 Top Star Wars high-tech trading cards. And don't forget, packs of this make great stocking stuffers for the kiddos. Good excuse to buy cards, right, Rob?
Absolutely. I absolutely love it. I'm using it as an excuse to probably pick up a couple of new WWE figures that borderline on dolls. They've moved past action figure status, but I'm like, well, I have girls, so maybe I could get away with it. Anyway.
Well, I'm so proud of you for admitting that the figures that you collect are, in fact, dolls. I'm proud of you. It's been a year and a half on this show. You finally admitted it. And that's okay. We support you.
Next up, not to be outdone in the universe of trading cards from the entertainment, another legacy franchise, Star Trek Beyond movie trading cards, comes out next week. Certainly wish we knew what more of these look like, but we've got a minor preview available and some just an amazing selection of autographs from the movie. But first off, 12 boxes, 24 packs, 5 cards per pack, 2 autograph cards, a relic or lapel pin card, and 1 metal parallel in every box. Look for autographs from Captain Kirk, Chris Pine, Spock, Zachary Quinto, Uhura, Zoe Saldana. Man, she's everywhere. Carl Urban as Bones, Scotty's in there. Everybody's in there. I mean, they're in there. 1 relic or pin card. Screen-worn costume cards from Kirk, Spock, Uhura, Scotty, Chekhov, and more. A 72-card base set. A metal parallel set. Numbering to be determined, but 1 in every box. Multiple chase sets, including quotables, metal character posters, uniform patch and pin cards, in memory of Anton Yelchin as Chekhov, and In Memoriam of Leonard Nimoy Spock. That's 15 total cards there. And randomly excluded sketch cards. The collector's album includes an exclusive promo card as well. Several case incentives available to retailers. Check all of those out on GoGTS.net.
Well, Rob, we are rounding things out with a bang. This product is so exciting that I just shared the link in both chat rooms. We're not going any lower end. We're just going higher. 2017 Historic Autographs Lineups Baseball Cards. Now, what does that mean? You've got to pay attention to that video that's playing or go to the link, gogts.net, and search for it. Historic Autographs has been crafting some amazing collectible products the last couple of years, and this one is no different. There are 8 boxes of this, and I wasn't able to find a case allocation. I have to imagine it's very small, though. Featuring World Series rosters for 50 of the greatest baseball teams to play between 1930 and 2016. Now, each of those teams will have 3 quad autograph cards to chase: infield, outfield / manager, and pitchers and catcher cards. Now, what does that mean? Well, again, watch the video. You see these are quad booklet cards. So every single box is going to have 1 quad autograph card from a stellar checklist, almost unbelievable checklist, such as, they lead off with a bang: Babe Ruth, Lou Gehrig, Bill Dickey, Jamie Foxx, Al Simmons, Connie Mack, Mickey Cochran, Rogers Hornsby, Kiki Kyler, Dizzy Dean, Hank Greenberg, Goose Gosselin. I could go on and on and on. Jackie Robinson, Mickey Mantle, Roy Campanella, Joe DiMaggio. I thought I was going to stop because the names weren't big anymore. Wait, no, Ted Williams, Willie Mays, Hank Aaron. The important thing to note, though, is, Rob, if you're getting autographs of these guys and you want a cool way to display them, look at the job and the design of these quad autographs. Absolutely crazy. And each team will have at least 2 of each card. So if I'm reading that right, that means there's 2 Babe Ruth autographs you can hit from this, 2 Roger Maris autographs, 2 Reggie Jacksons, even more fun ones like Tony Gwynn, George Brett, Kirby Puckett, Greg Maddux, Mariano Rivera, Derek Jeter, Pedro Martinez, Chris Bryant, which means that there has to be 3 other hot Cubs on that Chris Bryant card, and so many more. Check out the entire checklist at GoGTS.net, and definitely pay attention to this product and think about it. This is something in my business line that I think of for executive gifts. How sharp would that be if you know somebody's a fan of a team like the 1948 Cleveland team that went to the World Series, or the 1968 Detroit Tigers? I mean, those are unique pieces of history represented here. Really fun, exciting product to look for. Talk to your breakers and talk to your hobby shop owners about 2017 Historic Autographs Lineups Baseball Cards in stores this week.
Absolutely. And that wraps up a robust segment of Hot in the Shop. All right.
Whew. Very nice.
Yes. Get a drink.
Oh, I still got one. I still got the clear one. Still got the vodka.
Nice.
Just a joke. No one can drink vodka like that. It has to be water. Absolutely has to be water. Well, Rob, just one last quick reminder. Our big giveaway up to now has been the pieces of the past relic cards, printing plates, stamp cards, and the only way to get in on that is to go to GoGTS Live on Twitter, twitter.com/GoGTSLive, retweet our pinned tweet, and I'm going to draw some winners from that in a minute in the middle of this next segment coming up. But this next segment coming up is one of our most fun and interactive segments that we've had. It's been a little while. How excited are you to bring this back, Rob?
Absolutely. You know, it's time. It is that time for...
So, Rob, here's the thing.
Wait.
Sorry, yeah. Intro.
It's time for everybody's favorite game show. It's time for... Trade or No Trade. You were saying, Ivan.
Oh, I was just saying that we have to pick some people, and since we're on a delay, it's going to take a little time to pick people, so I wanted to jump into that. But, man, what an awesome intro. We should get one of those for every segment. So here's my thing, Rob. there is only one greatest cookie ever made. And since that's the theme of the show tonight, if you're watching, you have to be in chat to win, to play, because we need your response in chat. Tweet us right now, chat us right now, whatever it is right now, on what the greatest cookie ever made is. You got to not only be right, you have to be active quickly. That said, Rob, while we get our entries...
Well, wait a minute. I think cookies fall into several different categories. You have your mass-produced store level. You have your store level that's a little bit more premium. And then you have your bakery originals. And I have a different favorite probably for each one of those. So I don't know if I could pick just one.
Did I say favorite or greatest, Rob? You know how my games work.
My bad.
So real quick, Rob, while we're getting entries, can you go ahead and explain the rules of trade or no trade? Because not all of us are old enough to remember deal or no deal. Or wait, let's make a deal is the old one. Deal or no deal is the new one, right?
I get yes. I've thrown a little bit of a twist into it this time around. Basically, I am going to present our first contestant with two blind options. They will have their choice from box 0 or box 1. Okay? And at that point, the rest of the game will reveal itself. All right.
Excellent. Well, Rob, I can go ahead and announce the first winner. We're going to jump right in because we're on a delay, so it's going to take a minute for us to get your answer. Todd Kirk answered Oreo. Got to give it up for the Oreo, no matter who makes it. Even the fake Oreos, even though they're not as good as actual Oreos, you know, the Hydrox.
Yeah.
Even those are still the best cookie on earth compared to every other cookie. So we're going to give it to Todd Kirk on live stream first and foremost. Todd, let us know if, Rob, you want to show them the box?
Yeah. All right. So, Todd, we need to know from you which box you want to open. Box 0 or box 1? Which one would you like me to open?
And I apologize, I had to mute the mic real quick to type something because we're pulling winners not just from live stream and Facebook. We're also pulling them from Twitch and YouTube right now. I do apologize, Periscope. We ran out of bandwidth just a little bit. You'll be next week or next trade or no trade. So we have winners doing entries from there too. So I had to get that information. That said, Rob, can I see those packages one more time while we wait for Todd's response? Because
box 0 or...
Okay,
box
so a big square box. Oh, they're both big and square. Well, one's rectangular, one's square. Rob, I am a big fan of size does not matter. So I'm going to go with the smaller one because I think you're a trickster. I think you're a go against the grain. That said, I'm looking for Todd. Todd's telling other people to calm down. He sees what's going on. He knows that there's wolves out here in the chat room. Cookie arguments are going crazy. Todd says he will go with box 1. So he's eschewing box 0 for box 1. So let me write down box 1. I'm keeping track here.
All right. Box 1 contains a autographed 8x10 photo of Trish Stratus, WWE Hall of Fame legend.
Wow.
I will let you, Todd, keep this or trade it for what's in box 0 still.
Oh, wow. Are we doing that with everyone? Because that's going to be time consuming. With the delay. Sorry.
What, do you got something to do?
Things we... Kind of. My wife texted me an hour ago asking my ETA because the dog needs to go out. But that's just me. Don't let my...
It's just going to have to... Yeah, it's just going to... He's just... Rexford's just going to have to go on the floor and you're going to have to clean it up later.
Well, Todd did say box 1, please. I'm assuming that means keep box 1. That's the other difficult thing is reading the syntax here if it means keep or if it's on a delay. I see box 1 twice on here, though, if I'm not... Am I crazy? No, I may be crazy, actually. I only see box 1 once. So, again, you can't go with that.
So da-na-da-na. So keep
well, he said heck yeah. So here's the thing, because I'm seeing it on delay now. So I'm seeing him say heck yeah when you pulled it. So I'm guessing he's going to stick with it. But this is okay. This is what...
That's all right. That's all right.
No, it's not, Rob. I'm getting anxiety. You know me and silence. You know how we go. So, James, I'm taking... You pulled two from each. I'm taking three total. Okay. I misread. Okay.
And so what is his decision, Ivan?
His decision is... Oh, Todd's going to throw a curveball. He's going to gamble and go to box zero after getting something he was very happy about in that Trish status. Oh, Rob, tell me it's Yo Gabba Gabba again.
Okay, we have
show history was Yo Gabba.
I don't know if you guys remember these, but this is a
1963 cookies
package, a box topper from 2003. Excuse me, let me get this in front of the camera.
Oh, there we
Flair
go.
Baseball. And let's see what's in here.
Oh yeah, you got to rip that. Sorry, Todd, you don't get the fun of ripping. We got to see. You got to see how it went.
And it is a 5x7 sweet swatch jersey of then hot Mark Pryor.
Ooh.
So it's an oversized jumbo jersey swatch of Mark Pryor. So this is your prize.
Rob, keep holding that up because I want to see it. But real quick, I just want to let Chad Rasner on Facebook know that he's our next contestant. Again, with the delay, I wanted to get him notification early. But how awesome is that? Actually, I'm not a huge wrestling fan, but I wanted you to keep that up just because, wow, what a card. What a cool card.
Do you remember these?
No, I don't. That was during my dead era. That was during college for me. Who collected during college? Props to you if you did, if you had the time, the money, the energy, especially when college was in the middle of the 2000 blow-ups. That's a pretty awesome card, though. Who's going to bring those back? Jumbo, oversized, box topper, swatches. I'm looking at you, Panini. Come on, this sounds right up your alley. Do something that I like and bring these back.
So, all right. That's who's it. Contestant number two?
Chad Rasner. Chad Rasner is contestant number two.
All right, Chad. You can keep what Todd foregoed.
Okay.
With the Trish Stratus 8x10 auto, or you can go for what's in box number two.
Okay, so box number two is smaller than either of the other boxes to date. I'd say statistically speaking that the smaller box last time had the better value item. The Trish Stratus probably beats a Mark Pryor. So I would go here. I would take the gamble. I would take the gamble. What would you do, Rob?
Well, it's not really fair to ask me because I know what's in him. I know what's in the boxes.
Well, yeah, but Rob, we also know that you have preferences, so it could be something more valuable in the
box. Plus, I already have one of these Trish Stratus 8x10 autos on my wall right over here.
Yeah, Rob, still, even with all of that information, it has not changed the fact that I could see you pulling, picking the Trish Stratus over like a signed Mickey Mantle ball or something.
I'll tell you, the story behind these photos, which we've given away a few of, and I have more of, they'll be, you know, a prize. Back on Cardboard Connection Radio, we were going to start a exclusive, like, listeners club. Ooh. And put a membership package together. And, yeah, and so you're going to have access to exclusive content, and you were going to get a bunch of stuff. And Trish was kind enough after a segment to sign a bunch of autos for us. So that's why I still have them.
Oh, that's pretty awesome. Yeah. Well, that said, Chad did chime in. He said trade for box number two. So let's
all right,
get that open.
Box number two is... All right, two packs of Napoleon Dynamite Flippin' Sweet trading cards.
Flippin' Sweet is absolutely right. Tell us what hits could possibly be in those. And do we want to open them for him, or is that something that's so wonderful we got to send him?
I think we got to send him to him intact, and okay. He's got to share with us.
Yeah. Well, just a reminder, if you are one of the winners, and this holds true for the other winners of the relics that we're giving away as well, you have to email us, gogtslive@gogts.net, with your information so we can ship it to you. Don't just email us and say, I won! Sweet tots, to quote Chad Rasner, who seems almost as excited for that as he would be for a Trish Stratus. Lots of emojis over here. I'm glad I tuned into Facebook for that one. Email us gogtslive@gogts.net with your information so that we can send you your prize. And congrats to Chad Rasner. Hey, let's stick with Facebook. Steven Valletta, he didn't say Oreos. He said something else, though, that made me laugh, and I've already lost it in the feed because everyone is chiming in on whether to trade or not trade.
All right.
But he made me laugh. So Steven Eric Valletta.
Steven V.
What do you got to choose from?
All right. So back to... You can have this guaranteed collectible value Trish Stratus autographed 8x10 photo, or risk it for what's potentially, well, not potentially, but for what's in box number 3.
Ooh, box number 3. It says GTS on it. Again, I'm looking for something new, Rob. I'm looking for something fresh. Trish Stratus, it sounds like you're sending out one of those with every winner anyways. So I say go with
no, the box. This is the original one. This was the original one out of that box.
No, I know. I'm teasing you from what else you shared with us. But, you know, hey, are there cookies in any of these boxes? That's the real question.
There might be.
All right. So, Steven, let's see if you responded yet. Uncle Rico tweets. I'm seeing those. I like it. So, Steven, let us know. Ooh, Chris Reed came in last minute. Sorry, Chris, I just wrote down the last winner, and you came in with Twix. Ooh, I almost got one up. Steven says 3, box 3. Open up
box 3. Box 3. We have a Ryan Newman Hot Wheels wrenching and racing dual diecast set.
Ooh, interesting. Definitely interesting. I'm not sure where it falls on the value spectrum. I'm not sure where it falls on the collectible spectrum. It really depends on what Steven Eric Vialta is into. Congratulations, though, Steven. You won this Ryan Newman.
It says limited edition on here somewhere, I think.
Hot Wheels.
All right.
Die cut. Well, hey, while we're pulling that up, another one that made me laugh that was slightly off. Like, it's not the exact right answer. I had to give you some props, though. Ted Dastic Jr. over in live stream came through with Thin Mints. So, see, I'm not always
Thin
Mints. You don't have
to
say what I want necessarily. I am fair.
That's a chip cookie. Call me
Bruce Jenner. I enjoy Thin Mints. So is he still picking between, oh my gosh.
I like
Thin Mints.
I just spit all over myself. Oh my gosh. Woo! Okay. Next
Robert,
up,
are we going between two boxes, or is it still between Trish and box number 4 at this point?
You know what? I oh my gosh. Oh.
I think more people agreed with me from what I'm seeing in the feedback in the comments. More people agree with me in my comment than agreed with you that Thin Mints are a chick cookie.
All right. We will set Trish Stratus aside for the moment.
Oh,
who's up next?
Two fresh boxes. It's Ted Dastic. Ted Dastic in live stream.
All right, Ted. You can have what is in box number 4.
Okay, let's see box number 4. Okay, looks like an Amazon package.
Or... you can have what is in box number 5.
Oh, looks like a pair of shoes. Probably work boots. Hmm. Oh, it's loot crate. It's the loot crate. Well, that's interesting, Rob. You know, just because of the packaging, I'm actually going to go against my instincts and thinking you're contrarian, and I'm going to go with the loot crate one because it just looks mysterious and fun. And that is what I want to see opened, personally.
Okay. So that's the one you would go for.
That's what I would go with. Personally, now live stream.
But I wonder what our
delay.
I wonder what our contestant will go with.
Might take just a minute. Also, I'm looking up those that Ryan Newman. You said that's a dual Hot Wheels, right?
Correct. Wrenchin' and Racin'.
Is it
limited edition? 1 of 10,000.
Wrenching or Wrenchin'?
Wrenchin'. Wrenchin' with an apostrophe, hey, replacing the G.
Buy it now, ranging from $17.95 to $23.49. Oh, wait, those are lots. So that's about $10 probably. $12 with zero bids. All right, let me get back into live stream. We should catch up. Oh, there it is. Perfect timing. Box four. So he avoided my recommendation. He's going with the tried and true, trust in the Rob misdirection label.
All right.
Box number four. It says something good has to be in one of the big boxes, so he's picking the big.
There it is. You win a blaster box of Yo Gabba Gabba.
He's the man tonight. Oh, my goodness. That Trish Stratus is looking better and better every single box. What was this, Rob's garage sale?
Now,
ooh,
he can trade.
Oh, he's getting an additional trade option.
Yep. He can trade that Yo Gabba Gabba box for absolutely nothing. You're stuck with the Yo Gabba Gabba box. All right. Next up, who is the next
really funny,
contestant?
Robert, I was ready to tell you that, well, first off, the next winner, we're actually going to YouTube. Hey, thanks. Remember, I told you to tune in on YouTube. Chris James. Is that your middle name, your last name? Is that a wrestler name? Because it sounds like a modern wrestler name. Christopher James, you are our winner. And so I'm going to have to defer. I'm going to do some talking. I'm going to get in my headset, though, or from the chat over here. Our producer, James Gale, is going to be keeping his eye over there for your answers, Christopher James. Real quick, though, Rob, I was going to mention, if he did have a trade option, that the Yo Gabba Gabba Blaster does include a sing-along card, if I'm not mistaken.
Yes, exclusive sing-along card.
So you have to factor that in before you decide to just get rid of that or burn it. Definitely open it and play the song and take a video. Thank you, Ted. Rob, what are we looking at?
Our next contestant can choose the unpicked box of box five and roll the dice of what's in it, or take the guarantee of the Trish Stratus autograph.
Ooh.
8x10 photo.
Now, Rob, we have a saying in my house, which only I say, even after 8 years of being with my wife, called trust the Ivester. That's what I say, because I'm oftentimes right. So that's our saying in our house. Hopefully my kids will start saying it someday, so it's not just me. That said, you know my feelings on
box five.
That's what we should go with. And I'm hearing just now Christopher James saying, go with box five. Open up that loot crate.
Box five is a autographed poster of skateboarding legend and original Bones Brigade member Mike McGill.
Ooh. That's unique.
There you go. That is from Superheat, a skateboard trading card game. I think that flopped. But Mike McGill didn't. Creator of the McTwist, the 540.
Wonderful. Wonderful. Well, hey, Christopher, while you're emailing us, gogtslive@gogts.net to claim your prize. Let's get from Twitch now. Let's switch to Twitch. Outlaw Star 766. Outlaw Star 766. Are you on Twitter? What's your Twitter name? Let us know. Let us know who you are. Have you won before from the show from a different network? Awesome. Well, hey, wonderful, wonderful to see you here. Oh, Twitch is, there's no delay on Twitch. We're going to start doing all of our giveaways on Twitch. So, Rob, let's see what we got.
All right. We have box number six.
Looks like a card box.
Was somebody holding out hope that they would be the recipient of the Trish Stratus autograph photo.
So I think because the game is trade or no trade, we can pretty much say, okay, so you got the Trish Stratus, or you can trade it for box number six. Which do you want to do? Right?
That's right.
Is that fair? Well, Rob, you know me and what I would
box
do. I would go for box six, especially because it looks like it's a cardboard box.
Box six contains a...
Box six it is.
DC Superhero Collection from Eagle Moss minifigure of Captain Cold.
Oh, that's fun.
Captain Cold.
Trish is beautiful and wonderful and an accomplished athlete. That is a really awesome memorabilia piece, though. And
so that
Ella, are you a non-sports collector as well, or are you just a sports collector? Is that something fun for you? Well, while you answer that question, we need Wicked Pissed One.
Wicked Pissed One. That means you are the winner of the Trish Stratus autograph.
Oh, it is. It is
photo.
No trade. Trade. No trade. No trade. Well, I hope you don't mind, Wicked Pissed One. Thank you for watching on Twitch as well, even though we know that you're on Twitter. And Rob, I got... Oh, cool. Sounds like our outlaw star, Mike Levesque, 83, on Twitter. So go follow him on Twitter and thank him for engaging over there. Is also big on non-sports and very much likes that. So sounds like that was our big winner from the night. Rob, was there an unopened box somewhere, or was that all the boxes... There's boxes 0 through 6, right? And there were 7 winners.
Yeah, that's 7.
We opened box 0.
That's 7 okay. Numbers, yeah.
Didn't know if there was one hanging out. All right, cool. Well, hey, I do apologize. I got so engaged with that I only got halfway through drawing my winners for the other winners of the night. So do me a favor, Rob,
yeah,
and let people know what else is coming up.
All right, some programming.
It's Christmas time.
Some programming announcements. We are off next week, but you will not want to miss. If you need to go find a viewer, you need to go find someone to tune in for the very first time, if need be, because this is the show you are not going to want to miss. December 21st will be the GoGTS Live Christmas Spectacular show. And when I mean spectacular, it is going to be spectacular. Last year, we did the 12 days of GTSmas and gave a box away every day in the 12 days leading up till Christmas. This is going to be a little different this year.
Well, yeah, Rob, because I got a family now, so I don't know if I have 12 days to commit to the show this month.
It was all on social media, but this year, on December 21st, 2 weeks from today, the GoGTS Live Christmas Spectacular Show, we are going to employ the 12 minutes of Christmas. During the show, every 12 minutes, we will be giving away a sealed box of product.
Oh, my God. A box?
Yes.
Every 12 minutes?
Every 12 minutes.
And we're going to have a 60-minute style ticker clock in the corner entire episode?
We're going to figure it out, yes. Joe, I will leave that up to our producer, Joe Fallon, but I know he can find a way to put a countdown clock with a buzzer some way, somehow. And when that counts down, regardless of what we're doing, bam, it's going to be time to give a box away to a viewer, courtesy of GoGTS Live and our manufacturing partners.
I was going to say, keep in mind, Joe, if you need a little incentive for that clock, I will have to shut up every time the clock buzzes. So
yeah,
there is some.
There is that, so we got that going for us, which is nice.
To create that. hey, that said, Rob, that's exciting. So make sure you tune in. Make sure you tell your friends. Make sure you tweet. Make sure you go enjoy National Hobby Shop Day. And even if your hobby shop doesn't participate, take advantage of the chance to go do some shopping, do some holiday shopping. We all know that cards make great gifts, and mention it to your hobby shop that's why you're there, so that hopefully next year we go from 41 participants up to 82 or even more. Let's bankrupt GTS Distribution paying for pizza parties next year. What do you guys say? I'm all for it. That said, we've got some giveaway stuff to do. First off, I'm going to announce a little bonus winner. I hope he's still watching. Chris Reed from Facebook feed. Chris, shoot us an email. You're a bonus winner. It's been a while since you've won anything, and you've been watching and dedicated. So remember, GoGTSLive@GoGTS.net. It's really easy. You don't need to send me a tweet afterwards saying, what was the email address? It's the name of the show at the website. If you're not using that website for collecting needs, we still love you. You should check it out, though. There's great stuff on there. Future Watch, which tells you about some of the rookies and prospects. You open a pack of Bowman, you don't know who half these guys are or two-thirds of these guys. I've got Bowman from 2 years ago with guys that still aren't called up that could be the next Aaron Judge. Well, you can find out on Future Watch. Product Rewind, I saw in the chat earlier, Stevens Collectibles talking about a product from 2 years ago that's dropped in price by half, Portfolio Hockey.
Wait, speaking of Stephen Collectibles, shout out, he's a participating National Hobby Shop Day participant.
Yes, so we have viewers that are shops that are participating. So make sure you're watching. Make sure you're going. If you're in Illinois, check out Stevens Collectibles. He has an absolutely sick number of Chicago Bears autographs and especially Super Bowl autographed memorabilia items. So check that out. But all of that information is on the website, GoGTS.net. And you should not need to know the email. Once again, GoGTSLive, the show, at GoGTS.net. The website. Boom. Easy. First person I'm going to get an email from is going to be for the, it's going to be the bonus winner, Chris Reed, for that hit from last week. And then we are going to give away the, what's in your hand right now, Rob? You tell me. Interrupt my flow. Come on in here. I hope you got some cookies for me. Yell at me.
Franklin Delano Roosevelt.
So the first email we're going to get is going to be from Brett Howie at Desert Dog 99. Sounds great. Brett, I don't think you've won on the show before, so thank you for tuning in. Thank you for watching. Make sure you email us, GoGTSLive@GoGTS.net. Since it's the first time I'm seeing your name, I'm doing you a favor and giving it to you twice. That said, this next winner of the Eisenhower Relic is not getting it twice. Mikey Bedell, if by now you don't know how to claim a prize, you are hashtag blocked. Mikey Bedell, congratulations on that Eisenhower Relic from The Bar, Pieces of the Past, Series 2. I'm going to save the printing plate because I think that that's the biggie. I'm going to save the article stamp. We're going to jump to Richard Nixon Relic. I am not a crook, he said. Neither are we, and neither is this winner. Dan Calton, I've seen him do lots of fun interactive trades with other collectors on Twitter. Well, now he has this to add to his collection. Congratulations, Dan Calton. All right, which is bigger, the article stamp or the 101 printing plate, Rob? Which one's in your hand?
The article
That's
stamp.
That's the one we're giving away. Okay, so the article stamp, another regular viewer of the show. Congratulations, David Mackey. Go ahead and email us, GoGTSLive@GoGTS.net, to claim that. And finally, the 1-of-1 printing plate. Very awesome bonus hit from a two-hit box. We got a third hit. That's going to Joe Raniak. Regular winner in our fantasy football last year, I feel. Well, we don't have that this year, but we do have a piece of history for you, sir. So thank you to all the winners. Stay tuned on social media for our big, giant December prize pack. Enjoy next Thursday, even though we won't be here to share it with you. And make sure you come back the Thursday after that for a sealed wax box giveaway every 12 minutes. The 12 minutes of Christmas, brought to you by GTS Distribution, GoGTS Live, GoGTS.net, and all of your collecting resources.
And our winners of our participants from trade or no trade, you as well, please email us your mailing address and the prize you won at GoGTSLive@GoGTS.net. Thank you to our guest, Mike Briele of The Bar Pieces of the Past Trading Cards. Mike Fruitman, Mike's Stadium Sports Cards in Aurora, Colorado. As well as our associate producer, James Gale, executive producer, Joe Fallon. And thank you to Scott Allen, owner of Super Break, for providing those boxes for us to break. That's going to do it for another episode of GoGTS Live. For Ivan Lovgren, I'm Rob Bertrand. Have a great weekend. You guys know what to do. Always be collecting. Good night.